Hello everyone. So few of the groups have, I guess, have given us a great insight on what is feminism. And I think I can skip that part, right? So anyways, this is Rishabh Dwivedi from Section G. And since the childhood, I believe that every good side has bad side attached to it, or can say associated with it. And so today, we, as a collective group, would look into the bad side of feminism, which is pseudo-feminism. Now, we all get it that women over the centuries have been a victim of misogyny, sexism, and often been treated as a second-class citizen. And because of this, the concept of feminism was brought into existence in the 20th century. And ever since then, feminism has rightly stood achieving political, economical, and personal equality of sexes. But in a recent time frame, what we are seeing is, of late we are seeing new emergence of a trend, which is nothing but pseudo-feminism. So what is pseudo-feminism? Or rightly, to be more specific, who is a pseudo-feminist? So someone has rightly mentioned way before me that it is a person, or it can be anyone, who identifies himself as a feminist, but in the process, forgets the main concept of feminism, which is equality. And you know, this misconception, what we are seeing it, the impact of it in the way the laws are defined in our nation. We are seeing the way, we are seeing its impact in the way our society perceives feminism, thus deviating from the larger goal or idea or the vision with which this concept has brought into existence. So this is pseudo-feminism for you. Anyways, giving on a larger context, I feel that, you know, again, I will take a line from the other group that they have said that there's a thin line of distinction between feminism and pseudo-feminism, and I totally agree with it. But I also feel that, you know, it is in the process of identifying with the right set of feminism or with the right set of region that people commit mistakes. What they forget in the process is that feminism is not about battle among sexes. It is about collective fight against gender oppression. It is not about women's inequality. It is rather more about equality of all. What they forget is one can be feminist even when standing for the rights of a man. If I may quote a French writer, Beau, and he said that feminism never was, never will be a fight against men. It has always been suppressing the power that has perpetuated oppression. With this, I would like to show you a small clip that we have prepared. And thereafter, one of my teammates, Siddharth, will walk you through the process and give you further insight on how we are looking forward to tackling this issue.
Something wrong with the video, I'm sorry. I want to see a man beaten like a bloody pulp, with my high heels in his mouth, like a huge apple in a pig's mouth. As I grow more powerful and more famous, I get more power to hurt men. For mankind, or I should say for humanity, to sustain, there is a need for decontamination, an evolution which leads to the bare minimum of male numbers. Is this what feminism is? Because a lot of people have thought about it. Two of these statements were from leading feminists. One was Andrea, one was Mary Daly, and the other was Sharon Stone. That's a lot of us know her from Basic Instinct. A lot, like sir asked a few minutes ago, how many of us are feminists? A very few of us raised our hand. Why is it that people are not willing to identify themselves as feminists? Is it that something is wrong about feminism? Or is it that our definition of feminism is getting skewed? Anything that talks apart from equality is not feminism, it falls under the ambit of pseudo-feminism. If you are too feminine, you're not a feminist. If you are a homemaker, you cannot be a feminist. This is not feminism. Feminism is also about getting freedom from the stereotype, not just for women, but also for men. But what we are doing is we are stereotyping for men. All men are pigs. All men are the same. They're all the same. Every guy on Tinder is just for a hookup. That actually is true. But the thing is, Nidhi here can post on Facebook, all men are dogs. But I cannot talk in circles where women are bitches. Do you know these girls? I mean, you should. Because these are the brave hearts of our country. These are the Rohtak sisters. And why you know them? Because these two, these three guys on the streets of Delhi with belts. Apparently, these guys were teasing these girls. After a few days, we came to know these guys have been teased a lot. And they get money out of it. What they were doing was, they were beating women on the streets, or they would tell them that we won't beat you just so that you give us some money. This was revealed after 6 months. Think about the trauma that these guys would have been through. Siddharth will take up the other slide.
Hello everybody. Now I will be talking about the problem that pseudo-feminism has came into our legal system of our country, India. Now first, before that, there was a study conducted by the US government with the Pew Research Center. And they conducted the after the Me Too campaign, where they asked what were the major problems, like women falsely claiming sexual harassment assault, which is obviously is a major problem, because if they do that, the person may get fired, and they think that this is a minor problem, it's not a major problem. Obviously, they say here that men getting away with sexual harassment is a major problem. It is a major problem, but they think that a false claim of sexual harassment is not a major problem. That is a big issue. And same with the firing of the accused man without any evidence and all the facts. Now, what is how does the legal system works? That you are innocent until proven guilty. But what happens in the case of sexual harassment cases or the Dori harassment cases? That you are guilty until proven innocent. Now, what does this list do? Like, I like to share a story here. When I was in my year of engineering, I read a news that a boy was accused of raping a female, or rather his batchmate, in Noida in a top university. It was in a top university. So they were raping his batchmate. Now, fast forward to my final year of engineering, I read the final statement of the court of the state. That the boy was guilty, that he was not guilty. Now, in the same article, it was written that he was thrown out of the college. He has lost his image in the society. He has lost his self-respect, self-respect, and he was humiliated badly in the society, obviously. So, with the false claim, how does it affect a person? Male, that is the main issue here. Similarly, we go with the Dori cases, which is section 498A under the Indian Penal Code. Now, under this, if a case is filed against you and your family, the whole of the family goes to the jail without any evidence. Now, within this case, a lot of cases have come out as the falsely accused. According to a report, it is mentioned by the NBCR. The NCBR, that is National Criminal Bureau report, which claims that the 98% of the cases filed under the 498A IPC are false. So what does it say? That these laws, which were made for the betterment of the women, for the betterment of the rights to the women, are being now misused by the women themselves. So this talk about the pseudo-feminism, and it's not that there has been no try to change these laws here. There have been several times it has been tried to change the laws, but the feminist, so-called feminists, have said that it won't work. It shouldn't be there. It will dilute the function of these rules. This is a video. It is not working now. The video was about a person who was filed falsely under the 498A IPC, and he committed suicide right after the shoot of this video. It was an internet sensation around in 2008 or 9. Now this is NBCR, National NCBR, NCBR report that the 53% of the cases filed after the Nirbhaya rape case. First of all, the number of the cases increased, and so did the fake cases under that, which again says the pseudo-feminism, that how it is going in our legal system. Now further, my friend Devanshi will take over.
Hello everyone. Thank you, Siddharth, for giving me this opportunity. So talking about what the problem is. So we have to define what is feminism. We have to make sure it's not greater or less, it's not more or less, it's equal. Equal rights, equal justice to each and everyone. I will also let you all to take a pledge that in future, for example, if you have a daughter, or for example, you have a son or a daughter, you make sure that you treat both of them equal. The day you start making them equal, the day you are actually working to help this society. Society requires feminism. Society is very important. If talking about some statistics, there is, I was following one of the TED Talks, and I heard about that even a girl applies in firm, she has to make sure that it's 100%, 100% it satisfies all the requirements so that she is eligible. Whereas a boy is with 60% eligibility is applying for the job. Do you know why this is happening? This is happening because we haven't treated our daughters equal, and that's why this is happening. So just look about it. So we all have worked about it, and we have defined what the pseudo-feminism is. I want to like to know something about what pseudo-feminism is, and I want to take some points in it. Dress code, for example, dress code. There is always a saying that girls should wear this, we have that liberty of wearing dresses or that. It's not that we have the liberty. It's upon us to define in which we are comfortable with. That's very much important. This, if we are saying that we are like, if we wear in this way, then we are feminist, and if not, then we are not feminist. It's not like that. It's all that where we are comfortable with. That's it. How to tackle? So I was talking about this, what, how to tackle with pseudo-feminism, and we can tackle only with one way. That's equality. Equality in each and every law. For example, in India, if we are following the law, there is like the rape is charged is always against a woman, means a man. It's always biased. Why there is not gender equality? Why there is any law, such law, where we have both parties involved? It's not there in India. It's there in some Scandinavian countries, but still in India it's not. Do you know this one? What's written? Every male is a potential rapist. How do you feel? I just want to ask you all, how do you feel by reading this kind of statement? What kind of statement is this? there is a saying that with great power comes great responsibility. This is some irresponsible comment. So if someone has great powers and if he or she can drive a lot of things in for the society, and this kind of statement not only makes sure that this is what I could say, like it sometimes makes us furious that what kind of statement is this? Are we really justifying feminism like this? This is not. So when we come move forward and we make sure, we also make sure that these kind of irresponsible statements are not given by us, and not given, and we also should not take this kind of statement. And we all see that Arnab Goswami coming out and like shouting with this kind of statement. This statement is not at all, I think we should not market it very well. So that's it. Now I want Nidhi, one of my colleagues, to come out and go. Thank you.
Hello, I'm audible. Okay, as feminists and social activists, it is our responsibility to actually educate people on what our vision is, to provide them with a clear vision and lay out clear goals. So as feminists, we need to tell them it's about political, social and economic equality. We need to educate them about Article 15 of Indian Constitution, which states prohibition of discrimination on the basis of gender. We need to tell them that feminism is not tokenism. We need to tell them the real meaning of feminism. So this is our idea of laying clear vision and goals. The next solution in line is gender sensitization. Gender sensitization refers to the idea of bringing change in behavior through spreading awareness. Awareness can be spread by campaigns, projects, workshops, and training programs. We can have it at an individual level, at a college level as well. So this is the whole idea behind gender sensitization. Using gender sensitization, we can very well fight the problem of pseudo-feminism. If only we accept and understand the needs of the other gender, we'll be able to identify and tackle the problem of pseudo-feminism. The next solution that I propose is unified fight. Let's make it a unified fight. It's not just about women, it's about men too. It's not that women are required to come forward to fight for feminism. Men are also equally responsible, and the onus of responsibility lies with them as well. So let's make it a unified fight. The next solution is awareness through media, not just social media, mass media, as well as television media. We have seen films like Kianka, Erin Brockovich, and many other movies which show the real sense of feminism, which portray the idea of a strong woman. We have often seen men being victims of gender stereotypes, as we have seen in the case of Kianka. So we need to fight injustice through media. And we know and we have realized the power of media, what media can do to fight injustice in society. So we propose the idea of awareness through media. Thank you.
बैग जा
Okay, we are not done here.
Can he done khatam?
I would like to propose what an idea of a true feminist is. If I am a feminist and if I see a victim of sexual abuse, if she comes to me, I'll approach the problem in the same sense if a boy comes to me with the same problem. I would like to celebrate the concept of equality of sexes, not the superiority of one sex over the other. I would like to tackle the problem of myths. I would like to bust all the myths. I would like to lay clear vision and goals. There's also an open letter to all the men. Dear men, I know the problem of leaving your seat after a long day of work, even if we have seats reserved for our gender. I know I can stand as well. Dear men, if I go out with you, there is a problem of splitting bills. There is a problem of paying bills. I propose to split the bills. Dear men, whenever you are sad, you are going through a tough time, you have my shoulder, just like I have yours. Dear men, it's also about respect. When I demand respect, I promise to give you respect. And with this, we come to the conclusion of our slides, of our presentation. At the end, I would like to say that we have begun the change here itself from this auditorium. We have tried to educate the audiences present here. When we were given this topic initially, there were many of my friends from my classmates as well as people from other sections were trying to discuss what this term really means. And I was not surprised to see that they were not aware of the term pseudo-feminism. Through our presentation, I have at least made it clear and our team has made it clear what this term means.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, good to see the other groups at least ready on time, you know. So we had to go over sometimes because of some initial hiccups here, you know, some really few good quick questions. Appreciate.
Hey. You talked about creating awareness through media, right? So my question is, when you are creating awareness through media and if a person comes forward identifying himself as a feminist, there is a threat from the society being branded by the person being branded, right? So how do you intend to, you know, protect that person from getting a retaliation from the society so that people who are pseudo-feminists, they are encouraged to become a true feminist?
They remain feminists.
Probably the problem is with the idea of feminism. We don't know what feminism is. And people who are feminists, they are afraid to come forward. So it's supposed to be a group effort. Like if you want to come forward, the others need to support you. It's a common cause. Everybody has to take a stand. If we keep thinking that me coming forward is not going to make a change, there would be some retaliation. We want to see a change, we need to take some steps.
I think one way to tackle this is to don't even say that you're a feminist, but act as a feminist. You know, act as a feminist, and that action must begin at home, in your own circle. Right? You know, must learn all those things. You don't even have to go and, you know, beat your drums that I am a feminist. Can you act as a feminist and then you see that, you know, you cannot change the entire world. There would be repercussion, you know, because of the misunderstanding. And, of course, feminism has different sides too. You know, frankly speaking, I do not necessarily agree with all the tenets of, say, radical feminism. If you ask me, you know, I don't even understand them really. But, you know, for me, you know, if you talk about equality and equity, you know, then if you believe truly in that things, you know, you cannot. It is not just about gender. It is actually beyond that.
But in order to do that, you really have to understand that, you know, there are certain biases that we also inculcate, you know, nurture them, you know, how to overcome our own biases and, you know, first challenge yourself. You don't have to challenge anybody else. Challenge yourself whether you are truly a feminist. Act as a feminist and that's it. And again, just to keep you, you know, help remind you, you know, feminism is not about, you know, because I can cook, so you have to do that. I can clean, so you have to. No, when I can do that, can you do something else also? You know, what is your core area? But at the same time, respect each job. Respect each job. Each job is equally important. You know, there's one aspect that, you know, I don't know which group tackled that, you know, you can be feminist yet a homemaker. But as long as that is your choice, right? But at the same time, you also have to understand that, you know, we don't live in isolation. We live in groups, in communities, in families, right? You know, we have to learn those traits, you know, that not only benefit and in me as an individual, but also people that I'm connected to. You know, when you do that, then I think that is the change that you would see. I would like to see in you. You don't have to go and say, you know, yes, there are difficulties, you know, claiming that you're a feminist, people would mock. Sometimes if you're a man, you call yourself feminist, they would even doubt your sexual orientation. Right? You know, these problems are there. You don't have to do all things, but act as one of them. Okay. A few questions, you know, that I guess for all of you to remember, you know, so that you can probably a little more sensitive when you use terms like, you know, very freely use ref her or ref him. By the way, even men are, right, you know, but our law does not really, even the judges laugh at you if you say that things, you know, how often men are raped and harassed sexually. Not just because, you know, things get reported doesn't mean that it doesn't happen. So if you are truly, and for women to stand up, when you see something is wrong, it doesn't matter who the person is, right? You know, if you truly believe in equality, stand up and say that, you know, it is wrong. Right and wrong is gender blind. You know, what is wrong is wrong. And there are more women who probably require more, you know, lesson in, you know, this feminist theory, as well as, I think, not more women, you know, but women, yes, truly, because there are more women, you know, out there who do not have education. And therefore, they tend to believe in the age-old traditions that are actually keeping them, you know, holding them back from, you know, from this modern society. So if you really want to create that, you really have to fight for that. Fight in your own sphere, try and educate through your actions and not only words. Only when you speak through, you know, the big words and don't practice them, people don't follow you. Your actions should be much louder than your words. Thank you all. Right, you know, guys, those of you who will be presenting next, please come and upload your presentation. Delete.